Today, on the 1st of June 2021, I'm going to read to you the first part of chapter 5 from the book Women Who Run with the Wolves, written by Clarissa Pinkola Estes. Hunting when the heart is a lonely hunter. Skeleton woman, facing the life, death, life nature of love. Wolves are good at relationships. Anyone who has observed wolves sees how deeply they bond. Mates are most often for life. Even though they clash, even though there is dissension, their bonds carry them over and through harsh winters, plentiful springs, long walks, new offsprings, old predators, tribal dances and group sings. The relational needs of humans are no different. While the instinctual lives of wolves include loyalty and lifelong bonds of trust and devotion, humans sometimes have trouble with these matters. If we were to use archetypal terms to describe what determines the strong bonds among wolves, we might surmise that the integrity of their relationships is derived from their synchronization with the ancient pattern of all nature, what I call the life-death life cycle. The life-death life nature is a cycle of animation, development, decline, and death that is always followed by reanimation. This cycle affects all physical life and all facets of psychological life. Everything, the sun, novas and the moon, as well as the affairs of humans and those of the tiniest creatures, cells and atoms alike, have this fluttering, then faltering, then fluttering again. Unlike humans, wolves do not deem the ups and downs of life. Energy, power, food, nor opportunity as startling or punitive. The peaks and valleys just are, and wolves ride them as efficiently, as fluidly as possible. The instinctual nature has the miraculous ability to live through all positive boon, all negative consequence, and still maintain relationship to self, to others. Among wolves, the cycles of nature and fate are met with grace and wit, and the endurance to stay tight with one's mate, and to live long, and as well as can be. But in order for humans to live and give loyalty in this most fit manner, in this way which is most wise, most preserving, and most feeling, one has to go up against the very thing one fears most. There is no way around it, as we shall see. One must sleep with Lady Death. In wise stories, love is seldom a romantic tryst between two lovers. For instance, some stories from the circumpolar regions describe love as a union of two beings whose strength together enables one or both to enter into communication with the soul world and to participate in fate as a dance with life and death. The story I am about to relate to you is a hunting story about love. It is set in the frozen north. To understand this story, we have to see that there, in one of the harshest environs and one of the most stressed hunting cultures in the world, love does not mean a flirtation or a pursuit for simple ego pleasure, but a visible bond composed of the psychic sinew of endurance, a union which prevails through bounty and austerity, through the most complicated and most simple days and nights. The union of two beings is seen as Angakok, magic, in itself, as a relationship through which the powers that be become known to both individuals. But there are requirements for this kind of union. In order to create this enduring love, one invites a third partner to the union. The third partner I call Skeleton Woman. She could also be called Lady Death, and as such she is another life, death, life figure in one of its many guises. In this form, Lady Death is not a disease, but a deity. A deity. In a relationship, she has the role of the oracle who knows when it is time for cycles to begin and end. As such, she is the wildish aspect of relationship, the one of whom men are most terrified, and sometimes women also. For when faith in the transformative has been lost, the natural cycles of increase and attrition are feared as well. To create enduring love, Skeleton Woman must be admitted to the relationship and be embraced by both lovers. Here in an old Inuit setting and amplified into an original literary story from a short 5-line spoken poem given me by Mary Ukulat is the Skeleton Woman. Here too are the psychic stages for mastery of her embrace. Let us peer at the images which rise from the smoke of this tale. Skeleton Woman. She had done something of which her father disapproved, although no one any longer remembered what it was. But her father had dragged her to the cliffs and thrown her over and into the sea. There the fish ate her flesh away and plucked out her eyes. As she lay under the sea, her skeleton turned over and over in the currents. One day a fisherman came fishing. Well, in truth, many came to this bay once. But this fisherman had drifted far from his home place and didn't know that the local fisherman stayed away, saying that this inlet was haunted. The fisherman's hook drifted down through the water and caught of all places in the bones of Skeleton Woman's ribcage. The fisherman thought, "Oh, now I've really got a big one. Now I really have one." In his mind, he was thinking of how many people this great fish would feed, how long it would last, how long he might be free from the core of hunting. And as he struggled with his great weight on the end of the hook, the sea was stirred to a threshing froth, and his kayak bucked and shook, for she who was beneath struggled to disentangle herself. And the more she struggled, the more she tangled in the line. No matter what she did, she was inexorably dragged upward, tucked up by the bones of her own ribs. The hunter had turned to scoop up his net, so he didn't see her bald head rise above the waves. He didn't see the little coral creatures glinting in the orbs of her skull. He didn't see the crustaceans on her old ivory teeth. When he turned back with his net, her entire body, such as it was, had come to the surface and was hanging from the tip of his kayak by her long front teeth. "Aye," cried the man, and his heart fell into his knees. His eyes hid in terror on the back of his head, and his ears blazed bright red. "Aye," he screamed, and knocked her off the prow with his oar and began paddling like a demon toward shoreline. And not realizing she was tangled in his line, he was frightened all the more, for she appeared to stand up upon her toes while chasing him all the way to shore. No matter which way he zigged his kayak, she stayed right behind, and her breath rolled over the water in clouds of steam, and her arms flailed out as though to snatch him down into the depth. "Aye, aye," he wailed as he ran around. In one leap he was out of his kayak, clutching his fishing stick and running, and the coral-white corpse of skeleton woman still snagged in the fishing line, bumpety-bumped behind right after him. Over the rocks he ran, and she followed. Over the frozen tundra he ran, and she kept right up. Over the meat laid out to dry he ran, cracking it to pieces as his knuckles bore down. Throughout it all she kept right up, in fact grabbed some of the frozen fish as she was dragged behind. This she began to eat, for she had not gorged in a long, long time. Finally the man reached his snow house and dove right into the tunnel, and on hands and knees scrabbled his way into the interior. Panting and sobbing he lay there in the dark, his heart a drum, a mighty drum. Safe at last, oh so safe. Yes, safe, thank the gods. Raven, yes, thank Raven. Yes, and all bountiful Sedna. Safe at last. Imagine when he lit his whale oil lamp, there she, it, lay in a tumble upon his snow floor. One heel over her shoulder, one knee inside her ribcage, one foot over her elbow. He couldn't say later what it was. Perhaps the firelight softened her features, or the fact that he was a lonely man. But a feeling of some kindness came into his breathing. And slowly he reached out his grimy hands and, using words softly like a mother to a child, began to untangle her from the fishing line. Oh, na na na! First he untangled the toes, then the ankles. Oh, na na na! On and on he worked into the night, until dressing her in furs to keep her warm. Skeleton woman's bones were all in the order a human's should. He felt into his leather cuffs for his flint and used some of his hair to light a little more fire. He gazed at her from time to time as he oiled the precious wood of his fishing stick and rewound the gut line. And she in the furs uttered not a word. She didn't dare, lest this hunter take her out and throw her down the rocks and break her bones to pieces utterly. The man became drowsy, slid under his sleeping skins, and soon was dreaming. And sometimes, as humans sleep, you know, a tear escapes from the dreamer's eye. We never know what sort of dream causes this, but we know it is either a dream of sadness or longing, and this is what happened to the man. The skeleton woman saw the tear glisten in the firelight, and she became suddenly so thirsty. She tingled and clanked and crawled over to the sleeping man and put her mouth to his tear. The single tear was like a river, and she drank and drank and drank until her many years long thirst was slaked. Then, while lying beside him, she reached inside the sleeping man and took out his heart, the mighty drum. She sat up and banged on both sides of it. Boom, 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 boom. As she drummed, she began to sing out. Flesh, flesh, flesh. Flesh, flesh, flesh. And the more she sang, the more her body filled out with flesh. She sang for hair and good eyes and nice fat hands. She sang the divide between her legs and breasts long enough to wrap for warmth and all the things a woman needs. And when she was done, she also sang the sleeping man's clothes off and crept into his bed with him, skin against skin. She returned the great drum, his heart, to his body. And that is how they awakened, wrapped one around the other, tangled from their night together, in another way now, a good and lasting way. The people who cannot remember how she came to her first ill fortune say she and the fishermen went away and were consistently well fed by the creatures she had known in her life underwater. The people say that it is true, and that is all they know. Death in the House of Love. Inability to face and entangle the skeleton woman, is what causes many love relationships to fail. To love, one must not only be strong, but wise. Strength comes from the spirit. Wisdom comes from experience with skeleton woman. As we see in the tale, if one wishes to be fed for life, one must face and develop a relationship with the life, death, life nature. When we have that, we are no longer bumbling along, fishing for fantasies, but are made wise about the necessary death and startling birth that create true relationship. When we face skeleton woman, we learn that passion is not something to go get, but rather something generated in cycles and given out. It is skeleton woman who demonstrates that a shared living together through all increase and decrease, through all endings and beginnings, is what creates an unparalleled devotional love. This story is an apt metaphor for the problem of modern love, the fear of the life-death-life nature, the death aspect in particular. In much of Western culture, the original character of the death nature has been covered over by various dogmas and doctrines until it is split off from its other half, life. We have erroneously been trained to accept a broken form of one of the most profound and basic aspects of the wild nature. We have been taught that death is always followed by more death. It is simply not so. Death is always in the process of incubating new life, even when one's existence has been cut down to the bones. Rather than seeing the archetypes of death and life as opposites, they must be held together as the left and right side of a single thought. It is true that within a single love relationship, there are many endings. Yet somehow and somewhere in the delicate layers of the being that is created when two people love one another, there is both a heart and breath. While one side of the heart empties, the other fills. When one breath runs out, another begins. If one believes that the life-death-life force has no stanza beyond death, it is no wonder that some humans are frightened of commitment. They are terrified to go through even one ending. They cannot bear to pass from the veranda into the inner rooms. They are fearful, for they sense that there in the breakfast room of the House of Love sits Lady Death, tapping her toe, folding and refolding her gloves. Before her is a work list, on one side, what is living, on the other side, what is dying. She means to carry through. She means to maintain a balance. The archetype of life, death, life force, is grossly misunderstood throughout many modern cultures. Some no longer understand that Lady Death represents an essential creation pattern. Through her loving ministrations, life is renewed. In many folklores, the female figures of death often receive much sensational press. She carries a scythe and harvests the unsuspecting. She kisses her victims and leaves their corpses scattered behind her, or she drowns people and then wails long into the night. But in other cultures, such as East Indian and Mayan, which have preserved teachings about the wheel of life and death, Lady Death enfolds the already dying, easing their pain, giving them comfort. In curanderisma, she is said to turn the baby in the womb to the adverse position, so it can be born. end of the first chapter.